Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Write On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. Our guest today is writer-producer Greg Coolidge. You know his work if you've seen Ride Along, Employee of the Month, or The Troop. Today on Write On, he'll be talking to us about his new YouTube original show, Wayne. Greg Coolidge, welcome to Write On.
Hey, thanks for having me. I appreciate it, Pete.
Disclosure here, you are good friends with my boss, our VP of Product Development, Joe Jarvis. So let's not badmouth him today.
I will try not to. No, of course not.
So let's talk about how you got started in entertainment and storytelling in general.
People ask me sometimes, they say, you know, when did you know you became a writer? And I think it goes all the way back to sixth grade. We were allowed to leave campus to go have lunch at like KFC or Taco Bell or whatever as sixth graders. So if you think about that, how young we were, you had to have a note from your parents that would allow you to go off campus. And there was a guy that sat at the end of the corner of the campus, kind of near our middle school, in a car. And he was probably a volunteer or something just to check notes to make sure people could leave the school. And I rewrote that note, this fake note, to let me go to Taco Bell. I must have rewritten it probably 5 or 6 times, maybe more. And because of that, I was like, oh yeah, I think that was the first piece of writing I ever did. And I kept redoing it and redoing it and redoing it. And I think, oh yeah, that's how I knew I was going to be a little bit of a storyteller. And plus, I like telling stories just in general, like at parties or with friends or just sort of, I think it probably comes from the Irish side of my family. I don't know. The drinking side. Everyone always says there's honest Greg and then there's, you know, the other Greg. And the honest Greg's when I've had a couple of beers in me and then I start talking. But anyway, so I'm having a beer right now. No,
that's another podcast.
I should have. But I think that's kind of that's when I first knew I was sort of getting into it. And then I did a play when I was in fifth grade. I reblocked the show. You know, when you do a play in fifth grade, it's 20 minutes long. And so I reblocked the entire show the day of the production because I realized our music teacher had blocked everything wrong. And I went up to her and I said, hey, I'm going to come in from over here. And this is supposed to be the tree. And then the desk over here is supposed to be the campfire. And we were doing it all wrong. And I had brought all the kids out and I was like redoing everything. And she just sat at the piano and was like, okay. And I think because of those experiences, when I look back, I'm like, oh, wow. I remember the day of the show, all I did was look at my lines and look at the blocking, and I was so into it, and I could have cared less about adding and subtracting and diagramming sentences. And so that's kind of how I look back and I go, that's where I got the bug. And then when I met Joe, your boss, I saw him do a play in high school and I was like, well, I want to do that. That looks like a lot of fun. So I got into playwriting and sort of followed in his footsteps. And we both went to the University of Oklahoma together. When you're there, you do playwriting, you do directing, you do acting, and you kind of get a taste of what it's like. And I loved being an actor. And when I got a taste of what it was like to be a director, I was like, ooh, this is even cooler. Because I can kind of give a little bit of shape to everything that everybody's doing. But Rick's so much better at that than I am. And Janice is so much better at that than I am. So why don't we build the ultimate? So I just sort of found a passion in that. And that's kind of what led me even to when I moved to LA. I thought, well, you know what? I'm going to get a TV show, because someone had seen me in a play in Lubbock, Texas. And this woman who introduced me to Fox Television. And I thought, this woman's crazy. There's no way. And then I got a call from Fox saying, you should come to LA and meet with the head of casting. And so I did that. I flew to LA with my dad. And we came out here and we met the head of casting at Fox, and he basically said, I can't help you until you move to Los Angeles. And so then I moved to LA and I just was naive. I thought, oh yeah, I'll move to LA. I'll get on a show. This woman saw me in Texas and it'll be great. And then within a year I was testing and I went in and I saw the guys at Fox who had met with me. And it was probably, I don't know, 4 or 5 years of testing for things. As my dad used to say, I was the highest paid non-working actor, because I'd have all these great quotes and I wouldn't get any of the jobs. Ryan Reynolds would get them, or Jason Bateman would get them, or Danny Masterson. So I kind of came up with that group of guys that had all gone from show to show to show. And I remember my manager at the time saying, how come you're not booking these? And I'm like, well, I would hire the guy that did 3 other series before me. You know, that's who I would hire. So so during my downtime, I called Joe and I said, hey, listen, I'm reading for all these shows and they're making 100 pilots a year. And, you know, these aren't that great. I think we could do this like as writers. So let's get into this, because I eventually wanted to be a writer and a director anyway. I just thought the fastest way into it was through acting, which I was not right. I mean, I started commercials and doing things like that, which was great. It was able to, I was able to pay the bills with that. So Joe moved out to California and we started writing together. We sort of, you know, we wrote a couple of things and found an agent. And this is what I tell people, because they're like, how do you get started? Well, I always tell people, move out to LA and get into the stream, which basically means move out. I don't care if you work as a mechanic or you drive Uber or you do whatever, you're going to meet people who know people, and shit just happens that way. It's the only way to do it, is to kind of to get out there and get into the stream, and you never know what you're going to pick up along the way. Hopefully not herpes, but if you do, you know, there's a way around that. But you do, you know, I had done this thing with Joe, and I had written a script called Queen for Day about a guy that pretended to be gay to win the girl of his dreams. And a friend of ours was at a party with an agent named Emil Gladstone, who Emil, I think he's producing now, but he was a massive, massive feature agent. And he said, oh, I love that idea. Send me the script. So we sent him a script on a Friday. And on Monday, he called us and said, hey, can you write me something else? And we were like, oh, wow, the biggest agent in town wants us to write him something. So we went in and pitched him all these different ideas. And one of the ideas, it was so funny, one of the ideas was this play I had written in high school called God Dang It. And it was about this young kid. I wrote it with my buddy Matt Cumin. And it was about this guy, that this young nerdy kid that blasphemes God. And then God says, if you can do a better job, then you can be God. And so he's like, okay. You know, so Joe and I go in and we pitch Emil. We're like, okay, it's Jim Carrey. He's got bad luck with women. And he blasphemes God. And God says, you do it. And Emil goes, no. That'll never sell. And we're like, oh, okay. You know, 3 or 4 years later, Bruce Almighty comes out. So then we pitched him this idea where Adam Sandler is, you know, he's bad with women. He's a prize fighter and he's a terrible boxer. And he gets knocked out one day and he wakes up and he can hear what women think. And he's like, no, that's too silly and high concept. And that'll never, and we're like, okay, how about this one? How about a group of guys? It's Some Like It Hot in a fraternity. And a group of guys who are terrible to women have to become sorority girls and they learn what it's like. And he's like, oh, I can sell that. We can get that made. And we're like, okay, we don't even like this idea. But, let's see if we can do it. So that's kind of how we ended up breaking into the business.
Right. And that became Sorority Boys, which he was right. It did get made. He was right. He could get it made.
It did get made. And there's some things about it that I love and some things about it that I don't. And, you know, Wally, the director, he and his wife did a rewrite on it. And I love them. They're great. But they definitely had a different, much more of a, you know, Simpsons-esque vibe to the movie, that we wanted it to be much more John Hughes-ish and much more. And Wally and Maya's sort of comedy was much more broad. And we still loved the process and had a great time. But through that process, I was like, oh, okay, I think we need to, or I need to direct, because that's really where you get a lot more control over the tone of something and kind of building out your own vision. But it's fun to go back and watch that movie and go, oh my God, I remember pitching that. And I remember, you know, and Wally was so great. He's like, you should play this one role and you should come in here and do this. And I'm like, ah, you know, so much fun. So much fun. But that's really, but having, you know, getting to work with people like Wally, because he was a Simpsons writer. He's one of the guys that created The Simpsons, and it was so fun to work with people like that that you grew up on. You move to LA and you get to work with those guys, and you're like, oh, this is amazing. So that was sort of the first taste of it.
Now, what happens? Yeah, what happens from there? Like, you start actually pitching on more stuff. Do you start selling pitches? What's the next step? Because there's that one magic, like, okay, cool, lightning struck, but what happens after that stage?
I was lucky. Joe was lucky that we were kind of big idea people. And what ended up happening after that was we had sold a couple other things, did another project for Disney. And then we kind of went sort of different ways. Cause I said to him, I said, I think we need to direct something. And he was like, that doesn't appeal to me as much as just continuing to write. So essentially what I was like, well, then, okay, I'll go off and do this and we can kind of help each other and collaborate. You can do your thing and I'll do my thing and we can see what's going to happen. Of course, our agent was like, no, you guys are a team. And we're like, it doesn't matter. You know, and he's like, no, it really does. You guys are a label. You're a team. It's going to be different when you guys separate. And you kind of do, we said, well, we can continue to collaborate on things. He's like, as long as you do that. And then what ended up happening was Joe started working at, so funny, because when Final Draft came out, Mark, Joe and I were very active in contacting people saying, you should try this and you should try that. And so, of course, he fell into the Final Draft world. And and I was like, oh, that's actually perfect, because it used to drive us crazy, the original version of Final Draft. But anyway, and now we love it. Now it's so wonderful what you guys have done. But anyway,
we're very flattered. Yes.
Oh, yes. So essentially what ended up happening was we kind of went our separate ways. I went out with a pitch, which was Ride Along, actually. I had this idea, went and partnered up with my manager, my producing partner, who now runs DC, which is pretty great, Walter Hamada. Brilliant guy, wonderful guy. And we went out and pitched Ride Along because I was like, well, you know what? You got to follow up your other one with something else. And now that you're able to set meetings and we can get into rooms and meet people. Now, this was back when people were buying pitches, which they don't really buy anymore. They just remake IP that they have, or they try to find something, some sort of intellectual property that sort of exists. But back then, you could sell a pitch a year or two pitches a year, whether or not they got made or not. It didn't necessarily matter. There was a lot of typical research and development. And you would hear stories about, oh, I wrote an idea down on a napkin and they bought it. Sometimes that stuff happens, even today, but it's extremely rare. But so I went off and started pitching stuff, sold Ride Along, and then from Ride Along sold the next thing. And then I started became known as the pitch person. So I would go in and do these like little one-man shows and act out all my stuff. And it was a lot of fun. And I mean, I know over the course of 8 or 9 years, I probably set up 15 or so projects, probably have 20 something projects set up around town. And maybe some of them will get made, because you never know. Like, it took Ride Along 7 years to get made.
Wow.
It was one of those projects that when Ice Cube came on, you know, and Ice Cube's so good at finding who the next person is, who the next person that's going to pop. Huh. Like, he did it on Friday. He's just sort of that guy. And so when they finally came to me and they said, hey, we got Kevin Hart, I was like, what? I love that guy. I remember him from Soul Plane, thinking he was amazing in that. And it only took him 9 years to get another big movie. You know, it's like that star overnight, that overnight success in 7 years is, I guess. So,
right.
So then I started selling stuff as pitching and then started getting into the TV world. And, you know, when I'd signed with my agent the first time at Broder, they had said to me, because I was really interested in getting into the television side of it. They said, you know, we really think it's an easier path to go into the feature side and then go back into television. Because if you start in TV, you're going to have to start as the assistant story editor, the janitor, and you're going to have to basically work your way up through this cast system. And it could take you years and years and years. But if you go and you sell a screenplay and you get something made, you can instantly become an executive producer or creator of a show. And so I remember Ted Chervin telling me that story. And because I was friends with Bill Lawrence at the time, we played softball together. And Bill Lawrence is like the biggest TV writer in the world. And I'm kind of like barely squeaking by every year going, oh, I might sell this. So that's kind of that. And then once I started selling things more on a regular basis, then I got into the TV world. And it was true. Like, the first thing I sold at Fox, I was instantly like the co-showrunner, co-EP, and you jump right to the top. I was like, oh, this is pretty great. So hopefully, did I answer your question?
I think so. Yeah.
Sorry, long answer.
So what is it like jumping into TV? I mean, you've done that. I mean, you're there now.
I love TV. TV's great. You know, one of the things with my current writing partner, Kirk, who's also friends with Joe, we talk about it, because the fun thing about television is that it's instant gratification. You write something, it gets made, you get to see it come, you know, bring it to life. And if you've done something wrong, or you want to go a different direction, or you want to kind of move things around, you can do that in television. Whereas a feature film, you make your feature and that's it. And then you move on and you're like, oh, okay, that took a year out of my life. which is fine. It's so much, the process is great, but you're like, that's my final product. And there are times when you can go back and go, oh, I should have done this differently, or we should have crafted this a little bit, or we should have tightened that, or we should have given that more air. But with television, you can just do that all the time. It's a little bit more of an assembly line. And when you have responses from people that are watching it, then you can kind of craft things in response to that. You know, you hear about, oh, they're going to kill this character off because they don't like him, you know. So you can do that.
Do you actually listen to that? Do you actually look at feedback and read reviews?
I typically only read like the first, like when something comes out, I read like the first 10 minutes, because if you're not a darling in Hollywood, it's brutal out there. Mm-hmm. So many haters online. They'll just want to tell you everything, that all your stuff is terrible. And I remember making Employee of the Month. And we went to our first test audience. And I remember telling the studio this, because I told Lionsgate. They're like, we're going to make Employee of the Month. And I was like, seriously? You guys want to make that? This is kind of an Office Space type of movie. This is very small, quirky. And they're like, yeah. We think it's going to have a really cool place. And I said, well, I do too. But I just don't expect this to be a $100 million film. This is not going to be... This is going to be a small thing. It's going to take a while to find its audience. I go, we have Dane Cook, who is polarizing on, and you have Jessica Simpson, who's polarizing. And so it's going to be an interesting thing. So some people love him and some people hate him. Some people love her. Some people hate her. Do you guys realize that? And they're like, yes. And I said, okay. Well, then I remember taking my first meeting at Lionsgate when they gave me the green light. And I said, I want to keep the budget down. And the studio was sitting there looking at me, and they said, this is the first time this has happened in any meeting. And I said, oh, no. I want to be able to sleep at night. I want to be able to go to bed knowing that we wake up and we've made $10 or $12 million, that it's a hit, an opening weekend. So they were like, oh, well, then let's do that. I said, yeah, please. And so we kind of reversed engineered it that way, so that we didn't go in thinking like, is this ever going to make its money back? Am I ever going to get another job again as a director? Because the director gets all the praise and gets blamed for everything in the feature world.
Sure.
So anyway, making that experience was, it was an awesome, awesome experience, especially going in knowing that we were going to do well. And oddly enough, it was one of the biggest successes, because we were such a small movie. It was one of the bigger successes they had at Lionsgate for a long time. But when the movie came out, we got a review from Variety, and then we got a review from Hollywood Reporter, and they were both great. And I was like, awesome. This is really surprising. Like, I thought they were going to rip it apart. This is not an artistic piece. This is like, a very blue collar, fun, sort of simple movie. And as soon as those two reviews came out, I was like, oh, that's good. Cause I have a feeling when the rest of the reviews come out, they're not going to be so kind. And they weren't. They were brutal. And so for 10 minutes, I would look around and go, oh, there's a good review. I'm like, oh, yeah, maybe I'll read and see what that person said. But it's kind of like when you break up with someone, you need some time and space. And you're like, okay, I'm going to let things sort of live on their own. And so I didn't really dig in too much to the reviews, because I don't think they're very helpful, especially when you're making something like Employee of the Month. Employee of the Month is just supposed to be fun. You're not, we're not trying to win an Oscar. We're not trying to win any award. It's just supposed to be just kind of goofy. And so I typically don't get into that stuff. Now with Wayne, with the latest project, when you're 100% on Rotten Tomatoes, then you'd go, oh, I got to read all these reviews. What are people saying? Because it's almost like, did my mom write this one? Did my dad write this one? That's just over and over and over again. So that part is fun. But again, I try to avoid that as much as you can. Because, as an artist, when you get up, you're on stage and you're trying to make people laugh, and there's 100 people in the room and 99 people laugh, you always fixate on the one person that doesn't laugh. That's just a typical, like, what? Excuse me, ma'am, why didn't you laugh? I didn't think you were funny. Really? Everyone else did? So now I try to play the law of averages. Like, right. If there's 100 people in the room, and I mean, it's almost like when you test a show or you test an audience, when you do the audience testing, you want your audience to be 80% or above, 75-80%. Anything above an 80%, you get more screens, you don't have to test again. You know, like when we tested employee of the month, I think we tested it like an 84% and an 84% recommend. And the NRG lady came up to me, or Nielsen person came up to me and hugged me. Said, congratulations. I know this is your first movie. You did it. And I'm like, what? What did I do? They're like, she's like, you tested great. I said, oh, wow, that's really awesome. And so I knew from that moment, I was like, oh, you know, we still might get panned and we might do this, but the general public is going to like it. And then over the years, it has become one of those movies that people, oh my gosh, my favorite movie. Like I was in an Uber one day or a Lyft. We got cut off by another car and the guy yells out the window, this is an 81 Honda. How dare you? And I said, oh, I wrote that. And he goes, wow. What? And I said, I wrote that line. And he stops the car and he's like, what? You Employee of the Month is my favorite movie. You know, and I'm like, and that's what made reading those 20 minutes of I hate this movie pay off. Because I'm like, see, you know, that guy liked the movie. None of the critics did, but I didn't write it. I don't write. Like, we don't do anything for critics. We do it for the general public.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you can't really win everyone. You can attach some emotion to some people, and that's what it gets. Most people won't actually ever see your movie, but yeah. Some people will really be affected by it, and that's what you want.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. I think that's really great.
So I try to avoid it as much as I can.
That's great.
Long answer.
Oh, perfect. So let's get into Wayne a little bit. And yes. This is a YouTube original. So I don't know that we've ever had a YouTube original on before. So can you tell us a little bit about how that works, or is that a different experience?
Yeah, it was a very different experience, like nothing that I've ever gone through before, which was in a fantastic way. A buddy of mine who wrote on the troop, he was like the first guy we hired, Sean Simmons. He came in to meet with Kirk and I about a little over a year ago. And he said, I had this idea called Wayne. I grew up in Brockton, Massachusetts, and he starts pitching this crazy, basically the opening of the teaser. And we're like, that's really interesting. Like a John Wick in high school?
Right.
Like, really? That's really cool. Like, why don't we start talking about it and developing it? And, you know, so he would send us different scenes and go, this is what I'm thinking from the beginning. And he would send us a scene and we're like, well, this is really good, but where's it going to go? You know, so we sort of helped him assemble stuff and he would send us different parts of it. And I need some help on the action. And can you look at this? And and so over the, you know, the court, and we kept bugging him. We're like, we really love this. Send us more pages. And so over the course of like 9 months or a year, he finally sends us the final draft. And we read it and we're like, oh, this is really different. He's like, I don't know if we can sell this though. Was anyone going to want to buy this? And we're like, now's the time. Because it's streaming and it's cable and, you know, networks are trying to catch up with what's cool. Like, let's do this. So we basically take it out, give it to the agents. And essentially what ends up happening is agents get on board and then Rhett and Paul, so Reese and Warnick, come on board. And, you know, they're the Deadpool guys. They're, you know, massive. And they're so busy. And doing all these different things, and Kirk's texting them, bugging them, going, you should read this. And they're like, you know what? We have 7 projects and we're happy and we love you guys, but you know, we're not sure. And he's like, just trust me, you know, trust us. We're doing you guys a favor. So then we get a text from them. Yeah, this is really great. When can we talk about this? Thanks for sending this our way. And so they got involved and we all did notes and we kind of, you know, powwowed. And then what we did was took it out as a script. So we sent it to people that had read it and then they wanted to sit down with us and with Sean and kind of hear Sean's vision of the next few seasons. And so we did that and we ended up only taking it to like a handful of places and we had a couple places that wanted to buy it. And then, but what happened was YouTube said, hey, we're getting into this premium, you know, into the streaming business, into like real television, in addition to what we do with our regular content creators. And we want to do this as, you know, as a real show. And we're starting to do bigger, you know, bigger budget shows. And we said, oh, this is great. And we met with Amanda Barkley and Dustin Davis and they were fantastic. And we said to them in the room, we were like, hey, this is great. We would love to do a pilot with you guys. Love to talk about all this stuff, but we don't want to change anything. We want to keep everything the way it is. And I kid you not, they had the balls and the vision to go, okay. Seriously, they did that in the room. And we look at Sean, and Sean looks at us, and we left that. And Sean goes, "Is that ever?" No. And we're like, "This has never happened anywhere. Like, write this down, because this will never happen again, ever." Wow. So they let us go and make the show that they bought, which I can't tell you. You know, I've been doing this almost 20 years, and it's never happened. Never, ever. Never, ever, ever. Wow. Like, they usually buy it, and they go, "Oh, no, we know it's called Wayne, but we were thinking of calling it Dwayne. And we were thinking about whatever it is."
Right.
So it was a really, really cool experience. And we come to find out that Dustin and Amanda, just fantastic, fantastically smart people. And so when you're working with executives like that, I mean, we've worked with a lot of smart executives, but to have two of them, you're like, ooh, this is even better. So going really through wonderful. That process with them, making this show, their notes, I mean, they would call and they would say to us, "Hey, we have to do a 3 p.m. call." And we're like, "Oh, uh-oh. Shit's going to hit the fan. They're going to rip this apart. We're going to do that." And they're like, "Hey, note number one, we love this episode." And we're like, "Oh, okay. You know, note number two is on page 22. Can you use a different take? Because, you know," and we're like, "Oh, sure. Note number three, you know, we don't think that joke's pushing a little too much." We're like, "All right. Note number four is, again, we love this episode." And we're like, "Wow. Okay." And what happened with us, because we had a great cast, which was awesome. We had great producers. We had great writers in our writer's room. We just sort of hit the synergy that we locked in with the studio had with Suzanne Daniels and with Dustin and with Amanda. We all had the same vision. And when everybody has the same vision, it made it really easy. So instead of having the typical, like, "Hey, this is what we want to do in this episode," and having the network go, "Well, we really think," and having it be a little bit different because the network has a different vision than we do. We all have the same vision. So again, it was like almost having a couple more people on our team.
Wow.
So we all had this unified front, because people will ask us, they're like, "Hey, really love Wayne." You know, we'll go in and have a, you know, meetings at another studio or, you know, wherever with other producers. And they're like, "What's the secret?" And I said, "Well, you know, we all say, like, we all had the same vision of the show. God. We just got lucky." Like, it's never happened to us before.
Oh, my God. That sounds like heaven. That sounds like the perfect experience.
It is. It really is. The only thing better would be more money. Because I just mean in general, like, because we shot these episodes in 5 days.
Oh, my God.
And you look at the show, like, how do we do that? We go back and look at it and go, it's crazy.
That's what, 6-7 pages a day? These are about 30 minutes?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a lot.
It's a lot. It's too much. It's too much. It was overwhelming for everybody. Mm-hmm. But it was fun. I mean, you never got bored, that's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I'm sure. Like, "Hey, how'd you like Canada?" I'm like, "I didn't see Canada." Like, I saw the set and I saw the bed and I saw mostly the set.
Wow.
But it was fun. A lot of fun.
What are the other big challenges that come out of that tight schedule? Because we hear about tight schedules, but I don't know how deep we usually get to dive in that.
There is no production. I mean, what, Game of Thrones is 10 million an episode or something. Right. You still hear them saying, "We want more money. We want more days." You know, like, that's just how the business operates. It really is. I mean, unless you're Clint Eastwood and you shoot an 8-hour day and everyone's having dinner together at 6 p.m. like that would be the goal.
Right.
Or like, you start at 9 and you're done at 5. Apparently that's how they do it in Great Britain, but I don't know. So the secret to that is, when you're writing the scenes, is to be thinking ahead. I had this gaffer say to me recently, he's like, "When you type that word night, think about it." And I'm like, "Yes, I know. You know, because not only is everybody out there freezing to death because it's cold, but it's also costing way more, and you're having to light the scenes. Can't just do a bounce board and flip the camera around. You got to drag stuff around, and it takes so much more time. So when you're creating, you have to be thinking of production. And we're pretty good about that. I mean, there are times when we're like, "Well, we have to do the car crash. We have to do a car crash here," or something like that. Or if it's not a car crash, but I think when you're creating it and knowing what the parameters are, like, we started writing every episode really, really fat and really heavy and really action heavy. And we realized after the first episode, we're like, "This is not going to, we can't do this. But we need more, you know, we can still have moments, but we have to cut this way, way down."
Yeah.
Because it's just not going to matter. It's not going to make it. And then the other thing is we had to keep everything under 35 minutes every episode.
Oh.
So, you know, like a network show, turn in 32 pages or whatever, but you're only airing 22 to 24 minutes because of commercials and all that stuff. Since we don't have commercials, we're really cramming almost an hour-long episode into like 34 minutes, 35 minutes.
Oh my God.
Because if we're doing an hour on television, it's like 40 minutes, right?
Right.
We're cutting 5 minutes out of that, but we're cramming an hour's worth of material into that so that when people watch our show, they're getting a good solid 30 minutes, just bam, like all that sort of locked in, crammed in there. And it's kind of been fun because it created a new sort of feel to what you get.
Yeah, for sure. You know, when you're saying that, I had been thinking the whole time, this is a half hour show. It comes from comedy, but there's definitely an element that comes from a 1 hour. I mean, there's definitely a lot of drama to this too. So really you're sort of in a sweet spot. Yeah. Oh, that's really cool. So where are you guys at now? And this Wayne started airing January?
Yes.
So yes. Yeah, so out in January, we're recording this as of March. Where are you guys at now with the show?
Well, we're just waiting, hopefully, to see if we get picked up for season two. That's hopefully.
All right.
We're already developing stuff for season two, but you never know. It's a crazy business. But it's been really fantastic just having a show. I mean, it's really interesting because company like YouTube, we sometimes go, do they know how good it is? Like they have two or three shows that have had 20 million people watch the pilot.
God.
You know, you're like, what? You know, 100% on Rotten Tomatoes. Like you can build an entire network on two shows and they have three or four shows now that have done that.
Yeah.
And so it's really, really been fantastic as far as that's gone. So we're really just waiting right now going, hey, hopefully we'll get picked up for season two. But we have a lot of it mapped out for two and three. Yeah. So, I mean, we've been, you know.
That's great.
Like Sean just handed us, you know, we worked on the season, you know, episode 201. And it's epic. It's so great. So much fun.
Oh, cool. I
don't want to give anything away. But yeah, it's
sure.
Sort of. It's a wonderful way to restart for season two. People are going to be very surprised. And it was fun. Like I did the Q&A thing for the University of Oklahoma recently, which is my alma mater. And like half the table that I was sitting at was talking about Wayne. So it was a lot of fun to be able to go, oh yeah. You know, and they're like, what's going on? They were asking me all these questions. I said, I can't tell you. A lot of fun.
Well, what else are you working on now?
Well, we just finished a movie. We just did an indie movie called The Turkey Bowl. So we actually had that going. We shot that in my hometown back in Norman, Oklahoma. Just, you know, a small indie film, and it turned out great. And it looks big and expensive, like a big studio film, which is kind of fun. And we're in negotiations now for that to be released theatrically, limited theatrical release, and which is great. Especially in today's market, it's always fun to go make an indie movie and have it get released.
Yeah.
So it'll be theatrical and then VOD, Redbox, and all that sort of fun stuff. It's also fun for all the people that work on the movie to go, oh my gosh, this is turning into, like, not only was it fun experience, but it's turning into a big credit, you know?
Right.
So that's because, you know, when you do indie movies, you're always asking people, you're beg, borrowing, and stealing, and saying to people, please come out. And it's just people give their heart and soul to these films, not just the writers and the directors and the actors. It's everybody in the crew.
Right.
But it's just incredible how hard people work in this industry. Mm. I think people outside of the industry have no idea how difficult it is, like how taxing it is on your body, on your relationships. And then and you sit there and you go, why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? I think they did, what was it called? The Disaster Artist. Have you seen that?
Yeah, of course. The Disaster Artist about the room.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, they have that incredible line where she says, but my worst day here is better than everybody else's days, you know? And there was, I'm misquoting it, but it's something like that where you go, oh yeah, you know what? As hard as it is, we're still telling stories and connecting and having a lot of fun. So,
right. That's true.
Yeah.
Well, there's one last place I'd love to leave it if we can. You had a hint in there that's, I think, a really nice tip for people. But you said that as an indie movie, it's still going to look big and expensive. And it looks like you know, the studios put something into it. How do you achieve that? What are some of the cheats that you guys were able to use?
You hire the right people. No, I'm just kidding. Well, no, that is true. Carlos Gonzalez, our DP, he's used to working on big shows, little shows. Like he runs the gamut with everything that he does. So he's very good in giving a solid look and feel. And then we had basically our glee, like the cast and the crew, having them be as polished as they can be and rehearsed as well as they can be, so that even though we're running and gunning and we're moving as fast as we can, it doesn't look like we are. And so it's giving the actors as much time as they need to shoot a little scene, but also giving the lighting people, and also giving, I guess what I'm trying to say is, like, you find that energy that's going to be super fast and super quick and highly paced, but you're also not saying to someone, we got to move on. Yeah. You know, you're not screaming at people and telling the actor, you get one take, you know, like nothing like that. So that everybody has this heightened sense of energy that sort of stays throughout the entire movie. And the other thing is, like, you're not shooting one scene in an entire day. You know, we're shooting like three scenes in a day. Mm. And so it kind of clips along like you're doing a stage production. Like, oh, this is it. Lights are up. Here we go. And so that energy kind of translates to what you're doing on screen. And it's impossible to explain it until you actually go out there and do it. But I think the key to making something look good is to obviously light it as best as you can. Mm. Find out what you're, find a DP, or if you're a DP, if you understand lighting, get the right kind of camera and that look, and go out and do some tests and watch other movies that are similar. Because I remember telling Carlos, like, I would give him like 7 or 8 movies. This is the look and feel that I want. Mm. And then we would sit down together and go look and feel. And then we'd go out and do just a couple little tests and say, yes, this is what we want.
So you actually grab a camera and grab equipment, grab some lighting.
Yes, go out and make sure you can make it look that way.
Yeah.
And then what he was able to do, which helped us a lot, was he was able to go in and turn things up and turn things down in areas where, like, instead of, you know, because we shot it and the grass started to turn green, but took place during the winter, we wanted it to have a little bit more dead grass. And so he's able to take the grass through the DI and then tone it down a little bit. So we did a lot of those kinds of things, which gave the production a much, much bigger sense of value than just making two people sitting in a car with a camera. But but on the other side of that, it doesn't matter. I always tell people audio is way more important than the look. It really is. Because so many people watch on their phone now, or they watch in an airplane, or they're just trying to get content wherever they can. They're watching on their iPad. So if it looks decent enough and you have great audio and a great sound mix, that's really what's going to separate it. Like, that's, I even tell people that people turn in their auditions for stuff, because I love watching people on the computer for auditions because I love it that it gives the actor a chance to do it 10 times if they want. So they're not nervous sitting in front of me or in front of us going, oh, can I do that over again? Of course you can do it over again. Of course, you know, this is your time. But when people get to self-tape, they control the environment. Mm-hmm. And so when they send that in, and I always tell them, I say, make sure your audio is good. I don't like the shotgun mic that's 20 feet away that sounds like this. They're like, hey, Marvin, you know. So audio, and then having someone that understands the light and the look, and to play around with it.
You know, that's great.
It's cameras nowadays. I mean, it's incredible what you can get. I mean, our camera, our little red camera, was the size of half a loaf of bread, and our lens 7 feet long. So that's right. It's kind of switched, you know?
Yeah, right. Well, Greg Coolidge, thank you so much for doing this with us.
Absolutely. Hopefully it was good.
Oh, that's great. Thank you out there to all of our subscribers, and thanks to everyone who's left us those ratings and reviews on iTunes. You can stay in the know by following us on Facebook, or find us on Twitter as @FinalDraftInc and Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Until next time, right on.